Our New Testament reading comes from Acts, the third chapter. Acts chapter 3. Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms from those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. And fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, "Look at us." So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Then they knew that it was he who sat begging alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Now, as the lame man who was healed held on to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the porch, which is called Solomon's, greatly amazed. So when Peter saw it, he responded to the people, "Men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? Or why look so intently at us, as though by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and the just and asked for a murderer to be granted to you and killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead, of which we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yes, the faith which comes through him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Yet now, brethren, I know that you did it in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But those things which God foretold by the mouth of all his prophets that the Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. For Moses truly said to the fathers, 'The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Him you shall hear in all things, whatever he says to you, and it shall be that every soul who will not hear that prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people.' Yes, and all the prophets from Samuel and those who follow, as many as have spoken, have also foretold these days. You are sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying to Abraham, 'And in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed.' To you first, God, having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from your iniquities." Amen. You may be seated. On the first Sunday of every month after our communion service as part of the benediction and commissioning, I have used the text from Hebrews 12 and verses 1 through 3, the familiar words of Hebrews 12. And one of the calls of that passage is that we run with endurance, that we run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And as we think of that passage, I think there is an individual call in that passage. It's given to each one of us to do. It's also part of the calling for the church as a whole. It's been nearly 2,000 years since our Lord ascended into glory, was seated at the right hand of the Father. For nearly 2,000 years, the church has waited for the victorious return of Christ. And so the call is to wait, to serve as the Lord has called us, not to predict, but to wait in expectation. The call is always to be ready, to continue then to run this race with endurance. Peter, later in 2 Peter chapter 3, wrote about those who were denying the return of Christ. And part of Peter's correction to this false teaching is the truth that God does not count time like man does. Peter writes, "But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day." That's not some secret predictive formula. A reminder, God does not judge time as we judge time. He does not grow impatient. He does not become weary. We do. And then verse 9, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." We are often impatient. The Lord is long-suffering. He gives opportunity for repentance, the fulfillment of all his promises. Now, what's the connection, this theme of perseverance or endurance and our text from Acts chapter 3? The connection maybe doesn't jump out at you. I wouldn't blame you. The connection is sort of a circuitous connection. It comes from Isaiah 35, which we read earlier. Isaiah 35, 3 is quoted in Hebrews 12 and verse 12. It speaks of strengthening weak hands, making firm feeble knees. And then Isaiah 35, 6 speaks of the lame leaping like a deer. As we have observe, we don't live in the same dramatic age of signs and wonders through the hands of the apostles. We don't live in that same age. But this doesn't mean the work of Christ is somehow finished or diminished. No, the greater miracle of the salvation of lost sinners continues, greater than even miraculous healings of the lame. That continues. And also, the Lord gives strength to his pilgrim people as they walk along his highways, the way of holiness, using the language there of Isaiah 35. So the Lord continues to deliver sinners. He also continues to give strength to his people. And so the Lord Jesus Christ, though he is enthroned in heaven, is still at work today. That is why we are called to labor with perseverance, to serve our great King, to show still compassion for the lost. This is the theme we'll consider as we look at Acts 3. We're going to try to cover the entire text. First, the miracle, then Peter's sermon. We'll consider other points of application as we conclude. Let's look first at the opening verses of Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. I want to talk a little bit about the temple, Herod's glorious temple. I've spoken before about this almost unbelievable temple complex that Herod the Great built. Now, the temple proper followed some of the same dimensions as Solomon's. I think it was a much higher building. But the complex that Herod constructed was far larger. According to one source, it was the largest temple site of any kind in the Roman Empire. Some have estimated if you take all the space of the temple and the temple courts, it was the size of 29 football fields. So it is a massive complex. And if you would approach the temple from any direction, you would see the temple rising up like a mountain. That was the purpose. It looked like a mountain. And the farther in you went, the higher the temple rose. It was a mountain. And so the walls were about 10 stories high. So now there were different entrances for the temple. Obviously, when you have thousands and thousands of people, you have to have multiple entrances. I'm going to speak of what your perspective would be if you came from the east and you were going west. So entering from the east, going west, you would, of course, have to ascend many steps. In some cases, there were massive ramps. Other cases, just steps that would take you up to the main temple floor. And then as you came up to the main temple area, on each of the sides of the temple, there were porches. And the eastern porch was called Solomon's porch, connected with the temple that Solomon had built, or one of his palaces. The porch was a large area. There were two rows of marble pillars. There would have been a roof of carved cedar. Now, on one side was just the wall of the temple. On the east side, the western side of that one porch then opened to the rest of the temple area. And we have records. I don't know how these records have been preserved, but that each of the marble pillars was 37 and a half feet high, each one cut out of one block of marble. It would have been a beautiful area, and we would think the area of these porches, Solomon's porch, would easily have been as large as the cathedrals that were later constructed. Now, it was this eastern porch, Solomon's porch, that's highlighted several times in Scripture. Jesus, in John 10, Jesus was in Solomon's porch on one of the feast days, the Feast of Hanukkah, where he was almost stoned for what he said. It was then in this large covered area, Solomon's porch, that Peter would preach his sermon, as we see starting in verse 11. Easily thousands of people could have heard Peter speak. Now, if you continue to move west, leaving Solomon's porch, you would enter the great court of the Gentiles, the largest area, a square that is estimated to be 750 feet on each side, originally paved with marble. And this part of the temple was open both to Jews and Gentiles, the court of the Gentiles, the nations. There was a screen or a railing, I think it was about 4.5 feet high. It marked the boundary. If you were a Gentile, you could only go so far, and there was a sign actually that has been recovered saying you will die if you go any farther. So in that court of Gentiles could come, but only so far, and then they would have to stop. And then if you continued moving west, if you were a Jew, you could enter through another gate called the Eastern Gate, now into the Court of Women. The Court of Women was a square with a side length of about 233 feet. So it's a smaller but still a large area. The Court of Women could hold at least 6,000 worshipers. This would have been the area where Mary, Joseph, and Jesus met with Simeon that day. Then if you continued moving west, men could go further still. There was another gate at the other end of the court of women. Men could enter up through stairs, and there was another gate, and they could enter now the court of Israel. This is the outer part of the temple proper. This is where the sacrifices were offered. Men could go into that court. Women could only watch the sacrifices and other events that took place. Now, there is a question. Our text two times speaks of a gate called Beautiful. And there's a question. I almost went crazy trying to read all the sources. Which gate is this? And the end is we don't know. It's a beautiful gate. It may have been either on the western side or the eastern side of the Court of Women. Some suggest maybe it's an entirely different gate that we just don't know. All the temple was beautiful, but maybe there was something about one of these gates that was especially beautiful. But I'll leave that for your own investigation. Now, likely there were steps, part of this gate. And on one of these steps, it was Peter and John who then encountered a man. The man, we're told in chapter 4, was over 40 years old. Over 40 years old. Been lame from birth. And our text tells us at some point in his life, daily, this man then was brought to the temple. He was placed on the step so he could beg for a meager coin or whatever to be given to him. Well, Peter and John regularly went up to the temple. We read they went up to the temple at the hour of prayer, that is 3 p.m. in the afternoon, when the evening sacrifice would have been offered. Now, according to Acts 2:43, we read that there were many wonders and signs that were done through the apostles. Many wonders and signs. So why does Luke focus on this particular miracle? What's the connection why he places this in his text when he doesn't try to give us an exhaustive accounting? Well, we don't know entirely, but I think we can say for at least two reasons. First, this miracle led to Peter preaching another powerful sermon. Many are saved by God's power. And then, as we will see in chapter 4, this sermon in particular led to opposition. So this is the beginning now of opposition, the arrest of Peter and John, their trial, and then their release. So that may be why Luke includes this. Now, there's also a connection with the Old Testament scriptures, Isaiah 35, which comes out in part in the miracle and also then in Peter's sermon. Let's focus a little more on this miracle. There are several things that stand out. First, we can say, is the interaction of Peter, John, and the lame beggar. As I mentioned, this man was daily laid at this beautiful gate. Daily he was there. Maybe Peter and John had even seen him before. We can't say that. But Peter and John on this day took special notice of this beggar. And Peter told the man, "Look at us. Look at us." And then, as Luke has described it, the man thought, "I'm going to get something today. Someone's looking at me." And of course, what he received that day was far greater than he ever imagined. So second, Luke has recorded perhaps one of the most memorable phrases that Peter spoke in the book of Acts. "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." Now, I think we are to understand Peter is led to say this. And this is not some clever saying he had in the back of his mind. He was just hoping one day to speak this. I think we can say, no, in God's providence, in the leading of the Holy Spirit, Peter was led to take note of this man and to speak in such a way. What a beautiful thing for Peter to be able to say. Now, clearly, Peter was not getting rich off of his service to the Lord. Third, then, we see, and we'll note this also in Peter's sermon, there is a focus on the historic person of Christ. Look at how Peter identifies Jesus. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The historic person of Christ. Fourth, Luke gives us a simple but straightforward description then of this amazing miracle. Peter reached out, we would assume, with his right hand. He grabs the right hand of this lame man. He starts to lift him up. And as he starts to lift him up, Luke describes his feet and ankle bones. His feet and ankle bones in particular received strength. This man is now healed. Fifth, Luke emphasizes now this man is led to leap and to walk and to praise God. You see that repeatedly here. Now, from what we understand, this man would have only been able to go so far in the temple complex. As a man who is lame, he can only go so far in terms of seeing the sacrifices. We don't know exactly how far that could have been. Depends where this beautiful gate is. But now he is free to praise God. He is free to leap and to walk. Robertson says the grammar emphasizes this man repeated these exercises. I think that's part of why the crowd comes and sees, because they know this has been a man who has been lame. And that's the sixth point then of this miracle. Luke describes the amazement and the wonder of the crowd. What was going on? A man who had been lame since birth, he's over 40 years old. What is going on? Now, verse 11, we're going further than just the actual miracle. Verse 11 says, "This lame man then held on to Peter and John." Don't know if he has them each by one hand. Somehow he is holding on to Peter and John. Maybe they're leaving the temple, or maybe, depending on where this gate is, they're going further into the temple. But he is them by the hands, or he's grabbing them, and that brought a crowd together in wonder and amazement. In fact, we're told in verse 11, the people ran together. Might have been thousands of people who then ran to that area, that eastern porch called Solomon's Porch, greatly amazed. Now, before we look at Peter's sermon as our second main point, I want to share the comments of Dennis Johnson in his book on Acts. He writes this: "This healing may be thought of as both an X-ray and a preview." An X-ray and a preview. Interesting description. As an X-ray, it makes visible to outside observers the unseen inner cure that faith in Jesus produces. Astonishing as it is for a man of 40 who has never walked to leap in the temple, the cure of hearts paralyzed in sin is even greater. Then as a preview, it shows the final completion of Jesus' restorative work when believers' physical bodies will fully experience the salvation, which we already taste in the form of first fruits. Astonishing as it is for a layman to leap, it is nothing when compared to the cosmic restoration to come, the restoration of all things. So this miracle directs us to the present work of Christ. It also directs us to the final, the great coming of our Lord. So let's look then at Peter's sermon, starting in verse 12 through 26. We have about 391 words, if Microsoft Word counts correctly, 391 words that have been recorded. So likely this is just a summary, not the fullness of what Peter shared. But I want to summarize this sermon even further in four main points. I want to emphasize four points from this sermon. First, Peter's sermon is focused on the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at verse 13. "The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go." Peter uses a number of names for Jesus in this sermon. He glorified his servant Jesus. Now, I'm sure if you took a poll, many people would think that title of servant, maybe it sounds strange. Why is Jesus called a servant? Does it make him less than God if he's called a slave or a servant? And notice also at the end of the sermon, verse 26, Peter also speaks God having raised up his servant Jesus. So at the beginning and at the end, he calls him servant. Well, what's significant about the title of servant? Well, the answer is it connects us to the book of Isaiah. This title Peter uses is not one that he has made up. It's not a clever saying. Peter is saying Jesus is the fulfillment of all of those servant passages used in the book of Isaiah, especially the last part of Isaiah. Over 30 times you'll find the word servant used starting in Isaiah 41 through chapter 66. Now, sometimes that term is used of Israel. Israel is called God's servant. And yet, as Isaiah writes, he's clearly focusing not just on Israel. He is focusing on Jesus Christ. Listen to Isaiah 42, verse 1. I think the first usage of Christ in the servant portion. "Behold, my servant, whom I uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the Gentiles. My servant whom I uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him." So using this title, servant, Peter is clearly stating Jesus is the one that Isaiah prophesied would come. And as you study, and we don't have the time, but you study this language, it is so rich. It speaks, I think we can say, of the humanity of Christ, but also then his deity, as do the other titles that Peter uses to speak of Jesus. He calls Jesus the Holy One. He calls him just. He calls him the Prince or the Author of life. He calls him the Christ or the Messiah. He speaks of Jesus as that great prophet that Moses said would come. And all of these terms then are so rich in meaning. They speak of Jesus as both God and man. So many people want to speak of Jesus in their own terms. Whether it's philosophy or history or theology, no, we must speak of Jesus. We must know him as he has been revealed. The Son of God who took on human flesh, who lived, who died, who was raised to new life. Well, second, Peter focuses on Israel's sin and rebellion. If you compare Peter's sermon in Acts 2 and Acts 3, you'll find a number of similarities. In chapter 2, Peter also made this statement, "You have taken," that is Jesus, "by lawless hands, have crucified and put to death." So there's a comparison of how Peter speaks in chapter 2 and here. Here, let's look at how Peter highlights the sin of Israel. Verse 13, "You delivered up Jesus and denied him in the presence of Pilate." And then verse 14, "You again denied the Holy One and the Just." Interesting that Peter speaks of denial, something that Peter had done three times. Here, Peter uses that verb to deny two times. Verse 14, "You asked for a murderer instead to be granted to you." Verse 15, "You killed the Prince of Life," or the Author of Life, "whom God raised from the dead, of which we are witnesses." So Peter clearly pronounces the guilt, the sin, the rebellion of Israel. And I think we have to understand the significance of what Peter is saying, both historically and theologically. Historically, we were not all guilty for the death of Jesus, and that we are not all there. Peter is speaking probably to people who were actually there when Jesus was before Pilate. When Pilate was about to release him, and they said, "No, give us Barabbas." So Peter could speak to them in ways that you could not just speak to everyone. Now, theologically, we can say we are all guilty as sinners. We're all guilty theologically. We all stand under God's judgment. But Peter could say specifically, you are historically and theologically guilty for the death of Christ. Third, Peter calls then for repentance. Now, Peter was very honest with all who heard him speak. Look at verse 17. Peter is very honest. He can still speak with a measure of compassion. He calls these people brothers, brethren. He said to them, "I know that you did it in ignorance, as did also your rulers." Now, Peter's not excusing their sin, but he can say to them, "You did not understand fully what you were doing. I am making that clear to you now. I am revealing the fullness of your sin." And that is what God's word does. It reveals the fullness of our sin, even as it speaks with compassion. And then similar to chapter 2, look at verse 18. Peter points to the sin, and yet he can also say, this is all part of God's plan. Again, there's no attempt to figure out the mystery, as it were, of God's sovereignty and man's responsibility, but side by side, they are presented. This is your sin. This is also God's plan. And then verse 19, Peter calls for them to repent and to be converted. Repent and be converted. Repentance comes from the verb, which means to change your mind. I think it has a fuller idea as it's developed in the New Testament. It's not just changing your mind. There's a sense of sorrow and a turning from sin. Yes, there's a change in mind, but there is a godly sorrow as you are convicted of your sin. You're convicted that you stand before a holy God, and there is then a turning to God and away from sin. Peter then also uses a verb. It's translated in some versions as "be converted." Other versions read "turn back." And that's a literal translation. Turn back to God. James Boyce says this command could also be translated as to flee. And he says it's connected with the concept that there were cities of refuge. Cities of refuge, six Levitical cities that were cities of refuge. And if you killed someone unintentionally, You accidentally or unintentionally killed someone. You had to run to that city for refuge, for safety and protection. Maybe that is in part what is behind Peter saying, you didn't do this with knowledge. You did this in ignorance, but now you must run. Run to the refuge. Flee to the refuge and the one you put to death. That may be the call of Peter here. Again, a very rich call. And then fourth, Peter emphasizes reasons for repentance. We see this starting in verse 19 and following. And here, Peter's theology is so very rich. The first reason is that of forgiveness of sins. That your sins may be blotted out. That verb, blotted out, is only used, I think, two times speaking of sin. It's also used in Revelation, God wipes away our tears. But here, the meaning of blot is to remove so as to leave no trace. To remove so as to leave no trace. Other suggestions would be to destroy or to obliterate. Isn't it a beautiful, a powerful concept of God's forgiveness? To destroy or to obliterate so that there is no trace. Now, Scripture uses many words to speak of forgiveness. There is covering, there is removal, there is cleansing, there is washing, there is full payment. God describes his work in a number of ways. I think what they all have in common is that God deals with the totality of sin. God deals with sin in totality. It's not just the surface, it's the root and the surface. God blots or destroys sin, something that man could never deserve or earn. It's graciously given and received. So that's the first blessing, to turn in repentance, the knowledge of forgiveness of sins. Then second, Peter connects this forgiveness, this blotting, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. And here we encounter one of the challenging concepts of this sermon, in part because this word translated as refreshing is only used one time in the New Testament. This noun is used only one time here in the New Testament. Now, the verb refresh is used a couple of times. We read in 2 Timothy 1:16, Paul says, Onesiphorus often refreshed me. But the noun used only one time in the New Testament. It's also used one time in the Old Testament, in the Greek translation of the Old Testament. There it's used when Pharaoh was given relief. That is, when God stopped the judgment of the plagues for a time. We read in Exodus 8:15, when Pharaoh saw there was relief, he hardened his heart and did not heed them as the Lord had said. So how do we understand these seasons or times of refreshing? Is this a present blessing? It may be. Is it speaking of something greater in the future? Sort of the climax of blessing. And here is where commentators differ. F.F. Bruce said this, repentance would bring the people of Jerusalem a respite from the judgment foretold by Jesus, as it brought the Ninevites a respite from the destruction announced by Jonah. That may better fit the concept as Peter first speaks of forgiveness, the staying of God's hand. And then Peter also speaks of repentance connected with the return of Christ. Look again at verse 20. That he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. This, my friends, is a very deep and significant statement here in these two verses. Peter, I think we can say, he is emphasizing the present blessings. But there is also, as Peter looks ahead, he says, these blessings will reach a climax connected with the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a present blessing, but not the fullness. The fullness still awaits. I would invite you to turn to two passages in Romans. You've heard the expression, the now but the not now, the present but still the fullness to come, the already, the not yet. And Paul, in Romans 8, much of Romans 8 is speaking of our present blessings, but there's also then the awaiting of the fullness. Look at verses 19 through 21. Actually, let's start in verse 18. For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. I think we can say there's a connection here of Peter's sermon and Paul's explanation here. The present blessing, but we wait for the fullness still to come. Then if you would turn to Romans 11, Peter specifically calling for Jews to repentance, and as Paul explains in Romans 11, sadly, most of the Jewish people rejected the Messiah. And yet there is the promise here, the future hope, Romans 11, starting with verse 25. For I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved, as it is written. The deliverer will come out of Zion. He will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. So Peter is speaking of a present blessing. He's also speaking of the climax still to come. Well, there's more that we could consider here. But let's look at the end of Peter's sermon, verses 22 through 26. Here's where Peter again deals with themes from the Old Testament scriptures. What can we say is the summary in these verses, verses 22 through 26? I would say the summary is twofold: God's covenant and God's covenant judgment. There's God's covenant that you see throughout this. You are sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers. So God's covenant that he made with Abraham and Abraham's descendants, what a privilege was given to Israel. But then you also see the word of covenantal judgment. Look at verse 23. It shall be that every soul who will not hear that prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people. There is God's mercy, God's covenant, but there is also God's covenant judgment. And I think if we were to say the theme of much of the Old Testament scriptures, not every theme, but those two themes of God's promise, but also of God's judgment, are central through so much of the Old Testament scriptures, the prophetic books especially. So verse 26, to you first, God, having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from your iniquities. The glorious message of the gospel, the fulfillment of the prophets, is first preached to Israel. Then it would go to the nations. It would first go to Israel to turn them away from their iniquities. I quoted earlier from Dennis Johnson, astonishing as it is for a man of 40 who has never walked to leap in the temple, the cure of hearts paralyzed in sin is even greater. So we no longer live in the apostolic age, the age of signs and wonders. That is not the end of the work of Christ. That's not the end of his mighty power. And when you see someone that has been changed by God's grace, they come truly to saving faith. That we can say, that's a miracle. And maybe we don't use that language, but it's something of God's sovereign working. It's not based on man. It is God's work. So the glory of Christ, we maybe don't see it as it was poured out the same way during the book of Acts, but it is there. The glory, the work of Christ continues. We cannot be afraid or ashamed to think, well, we don't live in that same glorious age. No, we live in the continuation of that age. Now, secondly, as we look at this chapter, I think the first part of this chapter is significant, not only because of the miracle, not only because of this amazing miracle. I think it also points to the fact Peter did not leave for the temple that afternoon thinking, I'm going to preach a sermon. I'm going to go into Solomon's porch and have a revival meeting. I mean, we're not told everything that Peter thought. It says he went up to the temple at the hour of prayer. And so we can say this was God's sovereign leading. This was the power of the Holy Spirit, not some plan that Peter had to bring a revival. So one of the things we consider, we're not going to duplicate this chapter. Oh, we're going to plan this revival meeting. No, that's not the call of this text. But I think we are to look for opportunities, even as Peter did. We look for opportunities to bring a witness of the gospel, to show compassion to the lost, the lame, as it were. As Peter emphasized here, the power is not in us. The power is not in you. It's not your power. It's not your godliness, as Peter says. The power is in the work and the word of God. So we have no power in ourselves. And if you think, I can't be a witness in your own strength, no, you cannot be. The power is in God, in the message that he calls us to witness to. Now let's also consider the context of Peter and his ministry in comparison to our own day. We would estimate this is somewhere around AD 30, and Peter could quote from Deuteronomy 18 or make an allusion to Deuteronomy 18, and people understood what he was saying. You notice when the writers of Scripture give quotations, they don't have to cite chapter and verse. I think in part people knew what that was, and of course part of it is these things come later on. They could just make a statement and people knew, oh yeah, that's Deuteronomy 18. I was reading back in the 1940s when British forces were pinned down by the Germans at Dunkirk. The British commander sent a three-word communication back to Britain. He communicated this, but if not. Are you familiar with that story? Three words that brought about what's described as the greatest rescue of any army in history. And people understood, oh, that's referring to Daniel 3:18. That's what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, but if not, meaning if God doesn't deliver us, we're going to maintain faithfulness. So the culture in Britain was much different than it is today or in America. We live in much different times, abysmally, don't we? Where's the knowledge of any rudiment of God's word? It was described that people in the Obama administration thought when they saw the words "to the least of these," they thought that was a typo. That's a mistake. They didn't understand the significance of even basic biblical language. And so, again, if we're thinking, well, we can just preach a simple sermon without any context and all these people are going to respond, well, we have, in some sense, the same challenge. It's a different challenge in other ways. The challenge we have is to give people the understanding through the Word of God, to understand the person and work of Christ, to understand they are sinners, to understand that Christ died for sinners. And as we'll see in the book of Acts, the message the apostles preached in part depended on the audience. In part it depended on the audience. It's the same truth of who is Jesus, the judgment of sin, and the only way of salvation. Again, as we think of Peter preaching to this crowd, as we've talked about this before, what is the greatest crime in history? The greatest crime in history is the crucifixion of Christ. And so Peter presents his listeners, you are guilty of the most wicked crime in all history. There's no shying away from the truth. And that, again, is part of the witness we bring to a world that thinks of itself as special. No, we bring the message of judgment, but we also say this. If the sin of putting to death the Lord Jesus Christ can be obliterated, isn't that true of all our sin? Right? As we don't want to judge sins, but if God can forgive the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ, the point is all sins that we have committed can be forgiven. Do you know the blessing of sins obliterated, destroyed? Do you know with assurance the only way of that? Can you share that message with others? So the Lord Jesus Christ is at work today. That's why we're called to labor with perseverance. In the different ways, the different callings that God has given to us, we're all called, let's labor with perseverance. Let us bring that witness of the glory of Christ and of his kingdom. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for the book of Acts, for this amazing testimony, the miracle not only of a lame man being given strength, but then of the many who also responded to the preaching of your word. Hearts were changed, convicted of sin, and the way of forgiveness set forth. And so we pray indeed for the continued work of the Lord Jesus Christ in this age. May we not grow weary or be discouraged. May we keep our focus where it needs to be upon our victorious Lord, the fact that he is the victor. We are called to serve, whether we see always the fruits of that or not, or we long to see his kingdom expand. We long even for the fullness that will come in his glorious return. And so give us that right focus, that strength we each need in the inner man, whether we are young or old, direct us. And may this text continue to be of challenge and encouragement to each one here. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.